Now, the term quasi literally means resembling, but we often use it to describe something that actually isn't what it appears to be at first look. So a quasi-experiment, for example, would something that resembles a true experiment, but doesn't actually meet those criteria of manipulation and control. Now, quasi-experimental studies would logically have quasi-independent variables. So these are non-manipulated variables that are used to differentiate people into groups or scores being compared. And one of the most classic quasi-experimental independent variables would be gender. And any gender study you've ever seen, that's not a true experiment. It's a quasi-experiment. So quasi is kind of looked at as a bit of a problem. You know, it tends to confuse people. It looks like it's an experiment, but it's simply not. And that has a real important significance behind it. In fact, a lot of researchers, they don't even fully understand what they're trying to explain to people. They don't really understand what people need to know to be able to tell the difference. What I'm trying to say is, oftentimes researchers don't even specify that their independent variable is a quasi-independent variable. They just take it for granted. You know, they think, oh, we're doing a gender study, therefore, obviously, we're doing a quasi-experimental design. But the general public, they can't tell the difference. And even a lot of researchers, they will, you know, make that mistake as well. So, and this goes pretty deep. Like, for an independent variable, we tend to abbreviate it as IV. But for a quasi-independent variable, we don't abbreviate that as QIV. We just call that IV as well. So this can be really confusing unless you fully understand the study that's been conducted. Now, there's different forms of quasi-experimental research you could do. You could do what's called the non-equivalent groups design, which is basically just a between subjects non-experimental design. So this would ask a question such as, is there a difference between these two groups? Like, is there a difference between men and women, for example? Or you could do the pretest-posttest design, which is basically just a within subjects non-experimental design. And this would ask questions such as, has there been some change over time in the group that we're interested in? So when it comes to non-experimental, when it comes to quasi-experimental research design, it's basically the exact same thing as experimental design. The only difference, in many cases, it's literally like the only difference, is that that grouping variable is not manipulated. But just like with experimental design, you could do this, you know, between groups comparison or within groups comparison, or you can also do a combination of the two. Combinational design is also pretty popular, where you just have elements of the two. Now, that first type, the non-equivalent groups design, or non-experimental between subjects, that's where different groups of participants are formed under circumstances that do not permit the researcher to control assignment of individuals to groups. So the researcher just simply can't use random assignment, for example. And this is basically when two or more non-manipulated groups are compared and those groups consist of different individuals. So I already mentioned the most classic example of the non-equivalent groups design, which is males versus females. And tons of studies have looked at gender differences like that. Like, here's just one of the many. A researcher was studying aggressive behavior in the workplace and thought it would be interesting to look at differences between males and females. So they went to the workplace, did like a naturalistic kind of observational type of study where they, you know, separate people into groups and then collected data from them. And the results that they collected showed conclusively that males have higher levels of physical aggression than females in the workplace. However, why exactly the men were acting this way cannot be determined. And that's one fundamental flaw here. It's like we can tell the difference. We can say men are different from women in this case, but we can't explain why. We don't know about the cause. We can't have any kind of conclusion about cause and effect here. All we know is that there's something about being a male in this workplace that causes them to be more physically aggressive. So the general structure of a non-equivalent group study is the same. You know, the researcher has two groups and they're comparing the scores across those two groups, just like how you see here. But there is a baked-in problem. Because we can't assign participants to groups, we're going to have something like assignment bias, where there might be a fundamental difference between the participants in group one and group two that we don't want to be there. And this could introduce some pretty serious confounds to your study's design. So you're just never going to be able to get around that. And that's going to do a pretty big, you know, hit. That's going to make a pretty big hit on your study's internal validity. So there are things you can do to try to minimize that negative effect, that threat to your external validity in a quasi-experimental design, but you're never going to be able to make it go away completely. Now, one thing you could do is you could introduce control groups. You could do what's called a non-equivalent control group design, where you would add in additional groups to try to just eliminate some of those extraneous variables. But as I said, you'll never get them to go away completely. Now, besides this, you know, between subjects non-experimental design, you could also do the pretest-posttest, which is also known as non-experimental within subjects design. So this is a research design wherein the dependent variable is measured once before a treatment is implemented, and then once after it's implemented. Now, generally, all participants are going to receive this treatment, but we're just measuring them before and after they receive it. So the typical way you would do this is you have one measurement, you wait for a particular period of time, you apply the treatment, and then you do another measurement at interval after that time. So all participants get treated in the exact same fashion like this. Now, when it comes to these pretest posttest designs, they have their own threats to validity. And regardless of whether it's experimental or non-experimental, these kinds of time-related threats are going to be an issue. Like history, you know, stuff happens. Anything could happen between the first and the second measurement that you're not planning for, and that could contaminate the data. There could be some kind of change in the instrumentation. Maybe the devices you're using, maybe the measurement procedure that you've developed, it's just starting to break down. You know, nothing lasts forever. Maybe there's some kind of testing effect. You know, maybe by measuring your participants in the first session, you're going to result in some kind of practice. Like maybe they're getting better at the test, and the second time they get tested, then they'll just perform better. Or maybe they're just getting bored. Maybe they're getting restless and perhaps even hostile from being measured so many times that their later testing is not going to be as, you know, high scoring. Or maybe just your participants are getting old. You know, maturation is something that affects everybody all the time, and that could play a role in how your participants are performing on subsequent tests. But then there's a fifth one that's not very easy to explain. It's a statistical phenomenon called standardization, or it's more accurately called just regression to the mean. You know, if you just measure people enough times, eventually things are going to balance out and they're going to be normal-ish. I don't think I'm explaining that very well, but the whole idea here is you don't want to just test people forever, because that's kind of defeat the point. So here's an example of a pretest posttest design. A political consultant could evaluate the effectiveness of a new political advertisement by polling the voters before and after it's shown to them. So if you're to do this, you might find that the results do appear to show a change in voter opinion. And you could attribute that to the influence of the advertisement, but remember, any number of things could have happened between those measurements. Maybe the participants were affected by something beyond your study. Maybe they're just getting older. There's any number of potential explanations, but we can only be sure that your explanation is correct if it's consistent. Remember, replication is incredibly important in the scientific method. We would want to do this test again, at least a few more times to be sure. Now, there's different variations of this kind of pretest posttest design that you could do, such as the interrupted time series design. So this is a kind of quasi-experimental pre-post, where a set of measurements are taken at intervals over a period of time during which a treatment is applied or some kind of event occurs. So you could use it for treatments or events. So by treatment, I mean the manipulation administered by a researcher, and an event would be some kind of outside occurrence that's not controlled or manipulated by the researcher. Now, researchers can use this design to minimize a lot of these threats to internal validity I was describing. Because instead of just measuring the participants once before, then once after the event or the treatment, that now they're measuring them multiple times before and multiple times after. And when you do it like this, you can kind of balance it out. You can average out the weird stuff that might happen, so you can get a more accurate measurement of any treatment or event effects on the participant's performance. So this uninterrupted time series design is generally considered, you know, more useful in the sense that it gives you more accurate measurements for pre and post. But obviously there are going to be cases where you can't realistically measure people multiple times before and after. Like if an individual needs a treatment now, you're not going to want to delay in those kinds of cases. But there definitely are a lot of benefits to taking multiple measurements, like more than just two. I mean, if you compare only two measurements, like in a pretest posttest design, that will tell you if some kind of significant difference has occurred, if there was some significant change before and after a treatment was applied. But unfortunately, it can also leave out some really important information. Like maybe that change was inevitable. Maybe that change was always going to occur, such as some steady trend over time that could provide an alternate explanation. So like consider this data that you see down here. Now, clearly the scores for the pre-treatment are lower than the scores for the post-treatment. We can tell that by computing an average, just like you saw. But if you also just draw a line to connect the dots, you'll see that it doesn't actually look like there's a big difference between the two. It looks like there's just a constant, gradual upwards trend. So it's kind of hard to tell from just looking at data like this if the treatment actually did anything. So obviously this is an example where things didn't really work out in the researcher's best interest, but that's not really the important part. The important part of science is always to figure out what's actually going on. Like getting a good result doesn't matter. We want an accurate result. Now, there's a lot of different variations on these kinds of things, but some of the more common applications of time series design are things like a single case. So time series design, what I'm saying is this is often applied to single individuals to just chart like a patient's progress in recovery or how a client is responding to some kind of treatment. So this type of, you know, multiple measurements over a long period of time, this can be used to fairly, you know, accurately determine if an individual is responding well to some kind of, you know, medication perhaps, or whatever. So yeah, these are commonly called single subject or single case designs, and I'll talk in more detail about that kind of stuff in a later video. But when it comes to the non-equivalent group design and the pre-post design, they have their strengths and weaknesses as I described, but I mentioned earlier that you can also combine the two. So you could do what we would often just refer to as a combination design. Might also sometimes be referred to as a mixed design or a non-experimental between and within groups design. So this is a kind of quasi-experimental design that combines elements of the non-equivalent groups and the pretest-posttest. And by being partially between subjects, that's going to help you to eliminate order effect confounds. And by being partially within subjects, that's going to help you to eliminate individual difference confounds and reduce the number of participants that are needed. So combination designs are strongly preferred in those regards. Of course, they're going to be a bit more difficult. It's a bit more complicated to conduct a combination design or a combined design, but it does help to eliminate a lot of those problems. So here's just an overview of what this design looks like. So you have at least one between subjects factor, one grouping variable, and one within subjects factor, like a time variable, like, you know, pre-post kind of variable. So we would have two groups of people, and we would just measure those same groups of people again. So we're just tracking two separate groups over the same time period and observing how they are being differentially affected. Like maybe group one gets one kind of medication and group two gets a different kind of medication, for example. So that's the basic idea. And this combined design has been used effectively in tons of different studies. Like in just one example, researchers have established that memories are more easily retrieved if you're in the same context. So they wanted to follow that up by testing with a more true experimental design. Like they wanted to try to do this in the laboratory. So here's what they did. They showed all their participants a list containing words related to happiness and words related to sadness. Next, they experimentally manipulated the participants. So some participants were put into a room where they had to listen to happy music. And some participants were put into a different room where they had to listen to sad music. And then they would ask these participants who are either listening to happy or sad, so those are our two, you know, between subjects groups, they would have them write down as many words as they could remember from the previous lists. And as you might expect, the participants who listened to sad music, they could more easily remember the sad words. And participants who listened to happy music could more easily remember the happy words. So that's what I mean. So they track these people's progress over time, and they also compared them across groups. Here's what their data looked like. So participants who listened to happy remembered more pleasant than unpleasant, and participants who listened to sad remembered more unpleasant words than the other group. You can see that happy, pleasant words were more easily recalled in general, but the interesting thing is those people who listen to sad music, they had better recall for the unpleasant words. So I guess the take-home message from studies like this is that you should maybe try to listen to happier, more upbeat stuff. Maybe it's just going to put you in a better state of mind and help you to focus on the more positive things in life. Maybe. Now, there's a lot of different variations on this kind of stuff, like the pre-test, post-test control group design, which is exactly what it sounds like. It's a kind of combination design where the treatment group is measured before and after receiving a treatment, and the control group is measured at the same times but simply does not receive a treatment. So this is, if you go back to what I was saying a moment ago about, you know, comparing two groups over time, one of those groups basically just doesn't get a treatment. That's all it really is. So here's what that would look like. So you see both groups are measured twice, but the control group simply doesn't have anything applied to them. And this is actually a really great design because it helps us to eliminate a lot of those time-related confounds I was previously describing, like history and maturation and instrumentation changes and so on.